Hello and welcome to Speaking of Lake Ridge New Tech Schools. Speaking of Lake Ridge New Tech Schools is a public affairs program sponsored by the school district. Our goal here at Speaking of Lake Ridge New Tech Schools is to discuss issues in education that affect our schools, students, and community. In addition, we will do our best to provide you with answers to some of the pertinent questions of the day. Through our dialogue, we hope to introduce you to our faculty and staff and to other professionals involved in shaping your child's future. Our mission statement is transforming education, inspiring lives, empowering all. Speaking of Lake Ridge New Tech Schools, let's welcome Bonnie Mafis, who is the mother of one of our school counselors, Shelley Gates. And Shelley Gates is a counselor at Longfellow. You're a counselor and a teacher because I've seen you with the students, and you do a lot of teaching as well, Shelley. So I'm gonna give you two titles.
That's fine with me.
But your mom is here, and so I love to discuss the history of education. And you were around in the 60s. I think the 60s was a very, for lack of a better word, experimental time with anything that had to do with social services. Would you agree with that?
Yes.
And so you were a teacher at the renowned National Child Research Center. When you went there, did you know, like, okay, this is like the place to be?
It was for me.
Yeah, yeah.
I had three choices in order to start my first job, and I really, really wanted that school.
Did you know that it was, you know, because it was a research center, did you?
Not because it was research, but because it was such a natural way to teach children.
Yeah.
It wasn't through line paper and manuals.
Mm-hmm.
It was through experimenting with, well, not experimenting, but hands-on.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
We had little animals in the room if we wanted, like rabbits at one time. We had finger paints on plain paper. We wrote on, you know, use the large muscle control. You weren't confining children to learn we were warned it would happen later by manuals and fine muscle control that they don't have. It was just, they had an acre of ground there with three playgrounds and just a very good atmosphere for learning.
And now you graduated from where?
West Virginia University in Morgantown, West Virginia.
And so then when you graduated, you were very fortunate to find land that job.
Yes. Yeah. I found once I saw the school and went there, I knew that's where I wanted. And so I pursued it and finished my finals and went to Virginia the next day and started to work on Monday at the school. And it was a wonderful place to work. And the National Child Research Center has been there for almost 100 years now, and the children often go from there to Sidwell Friends and other private schools because we only went to kindergarten.
Mm-hmm. And
think it still just goes to kindergarten. It still has the same basic philosophies it had before, and it's still, I think, a hands-on teaching and learning, I mean. It also has such a natural surroundings where you have, you know, the squirrels and the trees and the places where the children learn the natural way.
How important is that in the early development of a child's education that they have the opportunity to explore and sort of be in nature and have that type of an education?
It comes down to what I hope people remember, that play is the work of children. That's how they learn. And so often they just want to cram the facts down them instead of letting them learn at their speed and through the natural way and through kinetic touch, kinetic and different ways. Because children have different ways to learn.
Was that a thing back then? Because, you know, in education now, I mean, that's, you know, you have to model instruction. Because people are different learners, and it seems like maybe in the last 25, 30 years that they began to recognize that Was that a part of it back then, or that's just the way you all were doing it?
That's the way, I don't know, that's the way we were. You know, we looked at the children and decided which was the best way for them to learn, and you do your best to teach them. But it wasn't as, play. As I said, the play was very important. We were always outside, I don't know, every day. We had a huge porch on the front of the school where they had tricycles and playhouses, so they were outside in nature as
Can
well.
Can I interject on that? From a counseling perspective, you guys have the right of it. The slower rhythms of nature, the exercise, for a young child's mental health and learning self-regulation, having all of that around is very healthy for their development. And I know this year at Longfellow, Miss Reddick has made a point to make sure our students have a full 30-minute recess each day because, as my mom said, being able to explore and, you know, learn to socialize. A lot of doing all of those things outside teach children both learning, you know, intellectual things, but it also teaches them emotional things that they really don't get inside of four walls. So I think she had the right of it, that large ground, the playground, the big porch. You know, that was actually extremely healthy for the kids in multiple ways.
And now, you know, when you were there and you taught senators' kids and all of the...
Senators, ambassadors.
Yeah.
There was a lot of professional people there. The children. President Johnson's daughter went there before I was there. But it was also involved with NIH, National Institute of Health. They had their offices in the school.
That to me is very interesting.
It was an interesting place. It really was.
Well,
it still is.
That the NIH was, and so what were they doing there?
They had some people who were there in their offices, and they would... observe the children, and if there was a child that had a particular issue that wasn't easily approached, they would study it and maybe come up with some ideas of how they thought we could help the child. And then they would come in often and observe and decide, well, does that approach work with this type of problem? And then we would have conferences with them. And we had a lot of parent-teacher conferences. We also had teachers from Marymount College, and the director was an excellent educator, Flo Gould Kirchhoff, and she suggested that that you have these student teachers, and she approved of it. And then she came to me one day and said, President Johnson has started a new program called Head Start, and we have some teachers that need to be trained for their first classroom. Could they come in and be your student teachers? And I said, of course. So the two ladies came, and they stayed for, I'm thinking it was about 6 weeks, maybe a little longer, and were trained. And then when they finished with their training, they went back to D.C. and set up their own classrooms, which were the first Head Start classrooms in D.C. And we were invited to come and to see their classroom, which was a nice invitation to see the first rooms. And we didn't realize at the time, you know, you do things and don't realize it's history. And that was part of history. And it was interesting to be a part of it and just be part of my daily life.
Yeah, because like you know, like you said earlier, the mid-60s, it was a time when the country was, well, we were at war and we were, you had all of these new ideas, and it was a very, very interesting time period. How did Head Start, you think, you know, change the way we teach children? I mean, from what
Well, it helped the children who had problems and or some with poverty to get a head start on their education because they learned their basics before they got into school. And as this, just as it says, they had a head start that they wouldn't have had without having teachers looking into their early childhood education, because that wasn't a big thing for the most common people back
then.
But
that's what you were doing at National Child Research, except you were doing it with very wealthy children.
We were. And then Flo went in, Mrs. Kirchhoff, changed that by bringing in scholarship children and coming in with different programs to bring in all sides of life.
Now, how did that work?
It worked just fine. It worked. You know, they fit right in. You know,
because DC is a pretty much it's an African American oriented city. So, were you bringing in black children, Hispanic children?
I don't know what all they have now because that was many years ago. But yes, there were black children that came in from DC area that were the poor section.
But you had black children before they
I had Ambassador Udochi's son. I had.
Yeah, they were still there. Which is like a whole different kind of level.
Right, and yeah. She was from the Ivory Coast.
Yeah.
But in that area in D.C. itself, in the neighborhood, mm-hmm. there probably weren't that many black families. We had some, but not as many.
Yeah. Because it still is sort of a...
This was between Wisconsin and Connecticut Avenue.
Yeah, so that's kind of a wealthy area.
Yes, it was.
And do you think that, you know, has it changed much? I mean, when did you retire from education?
Well, I quit full time in 1990 and subbed for a while.
Mm-hmm.
It was about 1990.
How had it changed? By the time you retired, how had it changed?
When I started teaching kindergarten in Harrison County in West Virginia, and the first time we asked for some kind of a manual, I think it was in math, the teachers kind of presented that to the supervisor, and she said, I don't think you know what you're asking for. She said, once we bring the manuals into the school, you're not going to be able to keep them out, and things are going to change. And she was correct. From then on, you know, it did change. You didn't have as much leeway in how you taught. It was described by the manual that the county bought,
mm-hmm.
and that changed every 5 years when they would bring in a new system. And some you liked and some you didn't, but she was exactly right. Once you bring the manuals in, that's it. Where we were brought in with the concept more of, you know, the children have large muscle control, not small muscle control. So you go to the chalkboard and you let them use their arms to draw the big O's and to make their pictures. And you use blank paper. Well, then they bring in the line paper. They try to make them stand these little lines. And so many people want to use coloring books and in the lines. We didn't do any of that. It was more let them use their large muscle control.
Would you say your style was more Montessori?
No. Montessori was a lot stricter than what we had.
Really?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And we didn't do Montessori.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, we had one child who had some kind of a problem, and they recommended he go to Montessori because it was more structured,
mm-hmm.
and he needed that.
In case you're just tuning in, the name of the program is Speaking of Lake Ridge New Tech Schools. I'm your host, Eric Johnson, and we have Shelley Gates, who is a counselor at Longfellow Elementary School, and her mom, Bonnie Mafis, who is a lifelong educator and was there back in the mid-60s when a Head Start got its beginnings. And as she has said, she taught at the National Child Research Center in Washington, D.C. Now, you have how many children?
Four.
Four. And Shelley is the only one who went in education.
Yes, my other daughter was in it for a while, but then she changed to something else.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And so, Shelley, did your mom inspire you or what?
Well, she taught at my school from the time I was in first grade through fifth grade, so I got to see what being an educator looked like, you know, like the feel of it, and I liked. She said that thing about the home-like atmosphere. I felt that way. Like a classroom back in my day felt very home-like.
Mm-hmm.
And as a counselor, I have a quilt in my office. I have a rocking chair. I like the feel of being able to work with children instead of an office where everything is very kind of, you know, professional all the time. I like the family-like atmosphere of education, and I got to experience that first in my mom's classroom. Mm-hmm. So I think that did make a lifelong impression because I didn't go into this field until I was in my 40s.
Really?
I substitute taught for several years in my 30s, but finally my youngest child went to, graduated from high school. And so I decided to make a change. And that's when I went back and got a master's in school counseling.
And so you what were you doing in your 20s?
Well, I had graduated early, actually. And I had planned on going back to school and becoming a professor. I wanted to be a history professor, which requires 3 degrees. But I got married at 19, and when my first child was born at 20, he had some birth defects and ultimately diagnosed as autistic. So I chose to do kind of part-time jobs that didn't require a college degree, just so I would have more time for his therapies and that sort of thing. So, life sort of had some unexpected twists and turns. That's why I waited until my 3 children were out of school before delving into full-time work, because I had so many hours each week in, therapies and doctor's appointments and all of that sort of thing.
So now you have time to dedicate to being a school counselor.
Yes.
Yeah. And so, going back to you, Ms. Mathis, working at the National Child Research Center, what did you personally learn from your experience there?
Well, I found that I have always known that I like to teach children, but I found that I could really influence their lives. And to this day, I have several of my students from back in the 60s who are on my Facebook.
Really?
They still remember.
They still
yes.
remember you.
They still remember, yes, including Jack Hotz. It was such a beautiful experience because it went along with the way I believe children should be taught and handled, not with rudeness or strictness, but definitely with discipline.
Mm-hmm.
And where they had a place to learn that was comfortable, happy, and productive. And National Child Research Center allowed you to do all of those things and to allow you to be creative. I could come up with an idea and go to the director and say, what if I try this, and they would listen and say, well, that's a good idea, try it. Or usually I got permission.
Mm-hmm.
She seemed to like my ideas. And she was a very professional woman, this Mrs. Kirchhoff, who then came to Indiana to Purdue.
Oh, really?
Yes. She was head of the early childhood department there,
mm-hmm.
and wanted me to come there to teach, and I stayed in West Virginia.
Yeah.
But it was such a good experience, and
do you feel like back then you all were into something special? Because, the history of education is, at one time, children actually started work earlier. And they, were just taught basics and then they got out there to work. Do you feel like you were a part of something that was changing education, or was that sort of a philosophy that was out there that we're going to redo things in education? And let me add this to a caveat. West Virginia, where you're from, was one of the poorer states in the Union. What was the education system like there certain parts of West Virginia?
I was from North Central West Virginia, and I have to say the person who influenced me the most in my life was my first grade teacher, who was an excellent teacher, and she just seemed to feel it come in my life through many things. She was like my nursery teacher in church and my first piano teacher and my first grade teacher, and I could tell you probably more of that year of my life than any other year because it was such an influence.
Mm-hmm.
And I had some good and some bad teachers, I guess we all have that. We did not have... It was a very small school. We had, and the high school went from 7th through 12th with about 400 people. And we did not have like a good chemistry lab or chemistry class, and I feel like I did not, wasn't prepared for a few classes in college because of that. Mm-hmm. But I did have some excellent teachers. And education has changed, of course, for the better in most parts. I do wish that with the younger children that they would remember that work, that play is the work of children, and that's how they learn, and to forget some of the manuals that they have come up with and the strictness with make them use their small muscle control instead of their large and many things, because I think of early childhood when I think of education, because mm-hmm. that's the field that attracts me and it always has. I've always liked to work with the younger children.
And it's interesting, Mom, that you ended up starting in the D.C. area, even though you were from an area that didn't even have kindergarten until my brother started in 1971. My oldest sister didn't attend kindergarten. Our county didn't have kindergarten at all until the 1971-72 school year.
But my sister, who was 7 years older than me, went to kindergarten. And I don't know how they had that.
So West Virginia had she went someplace where she was in the forefront of the preschool movement. And I don't know when they started Head Start in West Virginia. I know my daughter went in the 90s.
They had it in the 60s.
They did? Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. And you never even told me that. How come they had Head Start, but they didn't have kindergarten?
I don't know. Well, because the Head Start program was new.
And Head Start program was funded by the government.
Yes,
not the state.
Okay. Yeah, and because now, even today, I mean, there's some debate over, are you going to have, early childhood?
Yes, they've added so mm-hmm. much on it. We didn't get kindergarten in where we were in Harrison County. Until
it would have been 71-72 when my brother went, since Pam.
Yes, yeah, it was the experimental pilot program was when my son went, mm-hmm. right, and then I started teaching there about 2 years later in West Virginia, in kindergarten.
So yeah, because I take for granted because I had kindergarten when I was 5 years old, so I guess kindergarten was still it was still sort of just coming into its own, and early childhood was this radical new idea.
Well, this National Child Research Center where I was teaching is now about 100 years old. Mm-hmm. Okay, what is this? So it would have been around a little while when I was there.
Yeah.
And, of course, that was in a more advanced area because I'm in Washington, D.C. Like I said, President Johnson's daughter went there.
Mm-hmm. It
was only preschool. It was from 3 through kindergarten mm-hmm. at that time. I'm not sure what it is now. I'm sure it's changed some.
Yeah, yeah.
But it still only goes to kindergarten, I believe.
Do you think I'm asking both of you this. Do you think it's a good idea to start children in school as early as 3 years old?
Well, I guess it depends on the child and your situation, but yes, it can be good. I had 3-year-olds and I loved it. Mm-hmm. We had 3 to 4-year-olds. And they needed the socialization. They were happy. They learned. It depends, I think, on the family choices.
Mm-hmm. I'm gonna agree with you because of my 3 children, I went different ends of the spectrum. My youngest son was so incredibly clingy that had I waited to send him to school at kindergarten age, he would not have done well. But I was able to kind of ease him into it a little bit with preschool, and I don't think he would have done well without it. My oldest son didn't go to preschool. He stayed home and worked with me. But again, he's on the spectrum. He had special needs that I understood well. So there's so many factors that can influence that decision. Your employment, your family structure, your child's, like I said, level of shyness and socialization. My only daughter, my middle child, begged to go to Head Start. She was very upset with me. I was doing home daycare, and she said, "Why don't you get a job like the other mom so I can go to Head Start?" And so eventually I sent her for the last semester before kindergarten mm-hmm. because she just kept begging because her friends went, and she was jealous.
Wow, that's very interesting. In case you're just tuning in, I'm Eric Johnson. You're listening to Speaking of Lake Ridge New Tech Schools. The last person you heard speak was Shelley Gates, who is a counselor at Longfellow. And then the person before that was her mom, Bonnie Mafis, who is born in West Virginia, and through her education, she wound up working at the National Child Research Center. And while there, she did some training with the first teachers who got into early childhood, and so or preschool, early childhood. So you've seen a lot in your career as far as teaching children is concerned. Would you agree with that?
Yes.
What are some of the biggest changes that you've seen? Let's talk about the makeup of the family. How has the makeup of the family influenced the change of early childhood education?
Well, I haven't been in the teaching system itself except through my daughter here, and since the 1992, I would say. And even since then, it has changed considerably.
Mm-hmm.
You hear more and more of grandparents who are raising the children. It's the family dynamics have changed so much, and I'm sure it has changed the way the children behave in school and what they're learning in their behavior. We've gone through the time when parents disciplined their children and believed that they needed to follow the rules at home and at school, to where more or less the child rules, and if they decide that they want something, then the parent, not that this isn't all the parents, but it is a kind of general thing.
Mm-hmm.
The parents have been more lenient, I think, with the children and with the discipline from what I'm seeing and hearing.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody says, let's go back to the old ways, but not everybody, because they're still there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I don't know what, if everybody doesn't agree with the change, let's put it that way.
I think the most radical change in education started around the early 21st century, 2000, 2001, 2002, the advent of the cell phone and ultimately social media. I think that's
more freedoms.
Played.
They're given more freedoms to all that.
What do you think about that,
Shelley? As a counselor, that has had a huge influence. Huge influence. I worked at Portage High School for 6 years, and if you're not in school, I don't think you realize how many fights come from the cell phones. It wasn't that something happened in class that they would fight about. It was something somebody posted.
Mm-hmm.
It was something that somebody threatened on social media, or unflattering pictures that they took and posted, and mm-hmm. then the fights would happen in school.
Mm-hmm. And we're not casting aspersions on Portage High School.
Any school is the
because we have a great deal of respect to our friends over at Portage.
But that's the experience I have. And I've talked to a lot of people in every school. Now that I'm in K-4, there's not that many cell phones.
Mm-hmm.
But in general, every person I know in education, they deal with a lot of interpersonal disputes that did not start in the classroom. If it was in my mom's day, you could see the fight developing. Mm-hmm. Or argument or dispute, whatever you want to, whatever level it is, you could see, they said this, mm-hmm. and then I said that. They pushed me on the playground. You could see it happening. You had more control over it.
Yeah.
Now they're coming into the school with these grudges from electronic media that none of us could see. And so it's boiling under the surface. And that's mm-hmm. a big difference between the way you handled interpersonal conflict back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, cell phones, that there's other ways that it has influenced education, but that is a big thing in that you just can't see what's going on mm-hmm. in their electronic world.
Ms. Mafis, let me ask you this, because you're a very spry person, and but you're in your early 80s. But if you could go back those 60 years, would you still go in education the way you
yes.
feel?
Oh, yes.
That's your life choice. That's what you want to do.
And as I said, my first grade teacher was probably the biggest influence when I think about it, and I think she was there for a reason.
Yeah,
and
I mean, you would like to even teach today.
At my age, no.
No, but not at your
younger,
age. When you were 22 or 23,
I
24.
I don't know what it would be like going into it today, as I said, how much control you would have over what you were teaching and how you were teaching,
mm-hmm.
As we had back then. I could make up my lesson plans, and I could choose what how I was teaching a subject. And now I think you're more restricted as to what the county, whoever, at least where we were, it's the county tells you, the books that they choose. You have a little bit of input into the media, but not like we did back then.
Mm-hmm. Well,
maybe they're wiser than I am, and it's better, but mm-hmm. I preferred it the other way.
Well, no, you know, every generation is going to have a different opinion and outlook on the current generation, and so you're you know, you are a person of your time, and there are a lot of people who probably would tend to agree with you.
Yeah.
But we're about out of time, and so now I want you to tell us the story of the pepperoni roll, which is a uniquely West Virginia.
It is, and I think especially towards the North Central where I am, I don't know if it's as much in the southern part or not, but the pepperoni, the famous West Virginia pepperoni roll, started back when, as my grandparents came from Italy, and the men came to work in the coal mines, and the women wanted to make sure that they were fed. Of course, we're Italian. And one of the safer things to take in the mines was pepperoni because it didn't have to be refrigerated. So they took their homemade bread and put around the pepperoni and made these pepperoni rolls and baked them. And the men could take them in the mines, and no matter how long they were stuck in the mine, they had something to eat that was good for them. So that's how they got started, and the first ones were sold in Fairmont, West Virginia, which is mm-hmm. right where I am in the area. And we have some of the, I think Tomorrow's and Clarksburg are the best, but you know, there's a big contest every year who has the best pepperoni rolls. And we found that a lot of the states will not allow them to sell them because they're not refrigerated. Well, they don't need refrigerated.
Mm-hmm.
And they had become just a staple in West Virginia. And they're sold at the football games and the basketball games.
Now, is the pepperoni, because I know pepperoni can be a hard meat like a salami. I mean, how is the pepperoni made? Do you cook it?
Or? You buy it in a mm-hmm. long, it's in a stick. And you can either slice it, or you put it in slices or in sticks, like 3 or 4 inches long, and you wrap your bread around it. There's different brands. There's mm-hmm. Hormel. There's many different.
Yeah,
DeLallo's.
Yeah.
There's many brands now in West Virginia.
Because I truly, truly, truly love pepperoni. So
love our West Virginia pepperoni rolls, and so they're all different.
Mm-hmm.
Some are softer. Some are sweeter, you know, it depends on the bread that they make.
Oh, okay.
But
I think I would like the softer.
You get a good Italian bakery, and you will get a good Italian pepperoni.
Oh, okay.
And we have a lot of those.
I think we need to clarify, at no point in this interview did we say, my mom actually still lives in West Virginia and is simply visiting. So I think it's been a little bit confusing to not put that up there.
I don't think it was confusing, but yeah.
So she's from West Virginia.
You still live in West Virginia.
She taught in D.C. for, I forget how many years, and then she spent the rest of her life in West Virginia. So other than that brief period in the 60s for like 5 or 7 years,
well,
she's lived a lifelong resident of West Virginia.
Yeah. And you could have came to Indiana and taught at Purdue, but you chose to stay. And she kind of said that, that she chose to stay in West Virginia.
And then she ended up here.
Yeah. Now you're here.
Getting her master's from there.
So, but it's funny how things happen, isn't it?
It is. I just think back, if I had taken the job that Flo had offered me at Purdue, how our lives would have been different. Who knows?
Yeah, you would have been a Boilermaker.
Yeah, there you go.
I would have been raised a Hoosier instead of a Mountaineer.
But you actually would have been a Boilermaker.
A Hoosier Boilermaker, I suppose.
Yeah, because there is a distinct difference. Boilermakers are Boilermakers, and Hoosiers are people who went to IU. Now, the state says that they're the Hoosier state, you don't want Hoosiers and Boilermakers in the same room too long.
Boy, I've really stepped in it with that answer.
No.
Sorry, I did not mean to offend.
This is the Hoosier state, and I think Boilermakers are maybe jealous because they call it the Hoosier state instead of the Boilermaker state.
Oh, Well, see, I actually did not move to Indiana until I was 30. So oh, okay. I'm also a graduate of West Virginia University. And I had three children and a fourth grader by the time I ended up in Indiana. So now, I'm still learning this stuff.
West Virginia, the Mountaineers.
Yes, and that is like our argument. We are a whole state. West Virginia is a state. It is not part of
you
Virginia.
You said that there are people who actually did not
actually,
know West Virginia
to this
exists.
This day, there are people out here in this listening world who do not know that there is a state called West Virginia. They should have named us East and West Virginia, East Virginia and West Virginia, but they didn't.
Yeah.
And they think we're just a western part of Virginia, but no, we're a separate state.
And West Virginia is...
The home of Jerry West, Mary
Yes,
Barrett.
The home of Jerry West, and you have the most beautiful scenery, I think, of any place in this country, and that includes Hawaii and Alaska.
Oh my, thank you.
Driving through West Virginia, it is just—it's amazing.
In the summer, it is just so lush and green, and it's my favorite color.
When you're driving in the morning, and the mist is over, and it's just—it's awe-inspiring.
Can I tell you what the Twister said? He said,
"Chubby Checkers."
Chubby Checkers.
Oh yeah.
Said to me, I met him once.
You met Chubby Checkers.
I did, and. He said, you're from West Virginia? He said, oh, my eyes just water when I fly over West Virginia in the fall and look at those trees.
Oh, wow, yeah.
And I thought that was beautiful.
It is, because it's a beautiful state. I wish we had enough time. I would like to talk to you about the coal mines, and that was because that's a great story as well. But, Shelley, thank you for bringing your mom in to share her history with education with us. And,
my pleasure.
Thank you.
And thank
much for
you. And you continue your good work over at Longfellow. And you seem like you really enjoy retirement, so you continue to do that.
Yes.
And you've been listening to Speaking of Lake Ridge New Tech Schools. I'm your host, Eric Johnson, Director of Communications here at Lake Ridge Schools. Our producer is Aaron Smith. And if you want to drop me a line, you can do so at ejohnson@lakeridgeschools.net. Everyone have a great day.